Hi, I'm Dave Anderson. Let's go over how central banks, including the Federal Reserve in the United States, have adapted their policies to respond to the ample reserves held by commercial banks. First, let's be clear about what bank reserves are. Reserves are funds that banks have received as deposits or as loans from other banks or from the central bank, but have not lent out. In many countries, banks are required to hold some fraction of their deposits as reserves, typically 5 or 10%. Although in the United States, the central bank lowered the required reserve ratio to zero in March of 2020, so there are no required reserves here. Even so, banks desire to hold some reserves so they have money available to lend out to new loan customers or to invest or to return to customers who have deposited money and want to make a withdrawal. I mentioned that banks can borrow reserves from other banks. In the United States, they do that in the federal funds market, and the interest rate banks pay to borrow funds from each other is the federal funds rate. A central bank, such as the Federal Reserve, has a policy rate, which is an interest rate the central bank sets targets for and influences with monetary policy in pursuit of broader economic goals, such as low levels of inflation. The policy rate for the Federal Reserve is the federal funds rate. The Federal Reserve doesn't set the federal funds rate, the market does. But the Federal Reserve sets a target range for the federal funds rate and uses its policies to bring the federal funds rate within the target range. Let's look at the market for bank reserves, the price of which is the policy rate. The supply of reserves is determined by the central bank, so it doesn't depend on the policy rate, which makes the supply curve vertical. The central bank can use open market operations, buying and selling treasury securities, to increase or decrease the supply of reserves. The demand for reserves looks something like this. It starts out horizontal because banks have another option for obtaining reserves other than borrowing from the commercial banks. They can borrow from the central bank. When banks borrow from the Federal Reserve, the interest rate they pay is called the discount rate. Banks wouldn't demand reserves from other banks at a policy rate higher than the discount rate because they would rather just pay the discount rate. So the discount rate establishes a ceiling on the rate banks would pay other banks to borrow money. There is also a floor on the demand for reserves. In the United States, the Federal Reserve pays interest on reserves banks hold at the Federal Reserve, at a rate called the interest on reserve balances rate. Suppose the federal funds rate that banks pay to borrow from each other were lower than the interest rate on reserve balances rate the Federal Reserve pays. Then, banks would borrow at the lower federal funds rate and deposit the funds at the Federal Reserve at the higher interest on reserve balances rate and make a certain profit equal to the difference between the two rates. Taking advantage of opportunities like that to buy low and sell high for certain profit is called arbitrage. For example, if the federal funds rate were 1% and the interest on reserve balances rate were 2%, banks could borrow at 1% and put that money in the Federal Reserve to earn 2% and earn profit equal to the 1 percentage point difference between what they pay in interest and what they receive. Banks taking advantage of that arbitrage opportunity would increase the demand for funds in the federal funds market, which would increase the equilibrium federal funds rate. That would continue until the equilibrium federal funds rate rose to equal the interest on reserve balances rate. Since banks can always earn the interest on reserve balances rate, they will demand any amount of reserves at a federal funds rate equal to or below the interest on reserve balances rate, so the demand curve levels out at the interest on reserve balances rate. If the policy rate is between the discount rate and the interest on reserve balances rate, the demand curve for reserves is downward sloping because a lower price for borrowing money, a lower policy rate, makes holding more reserves justifiable. For example, so that banks can respond quickly to unexpected opportunities to make new loans or investments. Central banks can invigorate or cool an economy by lowering or raising interest rates, because low interest rates spur investments in things like businesses and homes and cars, and high interest rates discourage investment. by influencing the policy rate, the rate at which banks can borrow from each other, the central bank influences the broader range of interest rates paid through the economy, because when banks must pay a higher rate for money they borrow, the banks charge a higher rate for money they lend out. If reserves are limited such that the supply is within the downward sloping section of the demand curve, an increase in the supply of reserves will lower the equilibrium policy rate, and a decrease in the supply of reserves will increase the equilibrium policy rate. And the central bank can simply use the supply of reserves as the lever with which to adjust the policy rate. But in periods of ample reserves, supply changes don't affect the policy rate. In periods of ample reserves, it takes something other than an increase or decrease in the supply of reserves to change the policy rate. The central bank can influence the policy rate on the low end of the demand curve by changing the interest on reserve balances rate. As I've explained, if the interest on reserve balances rate is above the policy rate, arbitrage brings the policy rate up to the interest on reserve balances rate. If the interest on reserve balances rate is below the policy rate, banks will hold smaller balances at the central bank and lend out more money to other banks at the relatively high policy rate, increasing the supply of money in the federal funds market and lowering the policy rate until it approximates the interest on reserve balances rate. So the low end of the demand curve for reserves that is horizontal at the interest on reserve balances rate will rise and fall with changes the central bank makes in that interest on reserve balances rate. And as already explained, the high end of the demand curve is the discount rate. So the central bank can shift the high end of the demand curve by changing the discount rate, which serves as a ceiling on the demand curve. The discount rate and the interest on reserve balances rate, along with the overnight reserve repurchase rate, which serves like the interest on reserve balances rate but is available to a broader scope of financial institutions that invest in the Federal Reserve, are collectively called administered interest rates. And in times of ample reserves, they are used to guide the policy rate into the central bank's target range. If the supply of reserves starts creeping out of the ample range, open market operations, and specifically the purchase of treasury securities, can push supply back out to the right. Central banks have the awesome responsibility to steer us away from recessions and depressions. It's good to know they have tools like these. Happy banking.